All right. That is the song. And very good. We are going to do a very special show. This is just the beginning. This is part one of at least a few parts to cover the genre, the topic about jazz. And I think there's some really enlightening discussion and discourse that we're going to be hearing. And I am not a jazz musician. I'm a jazz aficionado. I love jazz. But I have invited three of the top individuals in the world, in this, and of course, in the world of jazz, in the world of music, who are both performers. They are also artists, artists, performers, and teachers. And I thought it would be appropriate because it's a topic and a subject near and dear to my heart, as well as these individuals who made their lives involved with music, but in particular jazz, jazz, R&B, etc., blues, all basically come from the same roots, and we're going to talk about that. In the background, you see Blues People, one of the first introductions I had to jazz, and in, I guess you could say, a more intellectual manner, and through also Joe Brazil, I learned a lot. The origin of jazz is, I think there's no dispute, it comes directly from Africa. It is the brainchild and the trust of people of African descent. When you talk in terms of the issue of rhythms, polyrhythms, tones, overtones, all of these things. And again, I'm not an expert. I just love jazz. And I think I'm also very critical of what's happening to jazz as an art form. And I have very strong misgivings about the fact that it's been so appropriated and misappropriated by others. And so we are going to have this lively discussion. I've invited, again, Wade Irvin, Julian Priester, and Gary Hammond, three of people I consider friends, but pros in the world, but they're also, like I said, artists, entertainers, and performers. So come on in, everyone. Julian's in, Wade's in. Hey.
Hey.
And Gary's in. Hey, everyone looks so good. Doggone it. You guys look better than me, man. Hello, Julian. Hello, Wade. Hello, Gary. Hey.
Yes.
Unfortunately, Booker couldn't make it. Booker Williams, another fantastic artist, performer, and entertainer, as well as a teacher. He said he was going to be tired of teaching today. But anyways, again, thank you guys for coming in, because like I had originally, and we had originally discussed, this is only the beginning. We want to really get into a lively discourse about, and I put that book behind me because I was really my first, other than listening to jazz and music with my parents, you know, growing up, that's the first time I actually sat down and read about jazz music, you know, the origin, the history. And it opened my eyes to a lot of things. And over the years, all of you know, it has I can't say it's transformed, but I can say very truthfully, where do we stand with jazz today? I mean, it is the art form created by selectively one group of individuals and, you know, people with origins in Africa. We know that. I mean, it's very common knowledge. Yet and still, every time I pick up a paper or look at a magazine and they have an earshot or whatever, I got to be honest, I don't see a whole lot of folks that look like, you know, the origins, the people who brought that music to this country and developed it. So I also want to make it very clear that these are individuals who have lived experience. They have lived it. They played professionally. They entertained. They performed. But they also taught, and they also teach, I mean. So they are teachers. And that's why I invited them. So the subject is, again, jazz, and where is it today? Where are we with jazz today? There are very few stations that play jazz around, at least in this area. And I would venture to say anywhere else in the country. I think you can go to California, and at one time, I think there were 6 or 7 jazz stations, FM, AM, etc. Now, I don't even know of any. And so, what is happening? And please, anybody, if you want to make a comment, if you think I'm going up the wrong tree, let me know. But I really want your thoughts on it. Because, like I say, I respect your work and your commitment to the craft. Your dedication to work with young people too, to promote the craft. So, have at it.
Okay, I'd like to start off with just making one statement here. The United States of America and its political, social involvement with life in this in this country. I have to point out the state of the mindset of the people in this country, not just the people, but the government itself. We're a capitalist country.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And as a capitalist country, it's really easy to turn everything into a commodity.
Mm-hmm.
And as a commodity, identification gets cloudy. The identification of jazz music as an art form has been covered up with the commodification.
Mm-hmm.
As a commodity, the music takes on different identifications just to sell it. It's trying to sell it, okay? Mm-hmm. So it's popularized. And that's in that process of being popularized, its identity has changed characters for each generation. There's a different character, you know. It's a different name. Like it was like when I came on the scene, it was bebop. After the bebop, it was cool jazz. After cool jazz, it was free jazz, and it kept evolving, you know. Just to try and keep it in the public's eye, you know, which in itself is a good thing. But as a result of that, the identification of that music as an art form, and not just an art form, but as a healing source, you know, the music. No, just let me clarify that. Sound itself, music is sound. Okay, sound stimulates the human psyche, the emotional self. A loud sound will startle the human being. Any sound will turn the human being's head around to find out what that sound is, where it's coming from. Is it dangerous or is it friendly? Okay. Music has all of those elements. Jazz music especially has all those elements. It's really a personal music. It's designed to communicate. But as a commodity, that whole concept is gone.
Yeah.
You know, people are not aware of it. You know,
there's
a difference between hearing and listening. We hear the music. We hear the music. The populace hears the music, but not many of them really have the time or the mindset to actually be quiet and listen.
Mm.
You know, listen. You know, we're so active. We're moving around, you know, getting on to this particular newfangled phase and to go into the next newfangled phase. So with each generation, things change, you know?
Right.
So
you're right. Commercialization, making money.
Yes.
That's the trump card. But I got, and let me explain. I could ask all of you to give a discourse on who you played with, how you developed your sound, all of that. We only have 54 minutes, but I mean, all of you have done, to me, great work. You, again, listening to you, watching you work, interact with young people, with the crowd, all of that stuff. And I am going to get into it, you know, kind of a little bit about yourselves and where you got started. But I mean, if I was to take your discography of all the works that you have done, we wouldn't have time to do it. But I really wanted to hit on this, the notion of where is jazz today? And like I said, I don't have an answer. I'm asking the question from the people who are the pros, and that's why I'm going to leave it up to you.
Well,
Gary.
Let me say this. Julian, since you have went through decades, would you describe to the people and give them a simplistic idea about that word, jazz? That it's not even something that's even a commodity, please.
Oh, okay. That word jazz, it came out of in the early days in the history of the music. The music was performed in a lot of different places, but one of the main places it was performed in the Red Light District in New Orleans, in the brothels, the brothels of New York. So that name jazz actually came out of that environment. The name jazz is related to the name how can I pronounce it? Jizz. It's spelled J-I-Z-Z instead of J-A-Z-Z. And if you look in the dictionary and look up the word J-I-Z-Z, and it'll tell you, or if you just look up the word jazz, it'll relate to the word J-I-Z-Z, excuse me. I'm getting excited. The word J-I-Z-Z is more associated with the environment of the brothel. It's about sex. Mm-hmm. It's about ejaculations, you know? So how can you respect something with that reference? Right.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And Wade, you're from that part of the country, you know, New Orleans area. You're from Louisiana. You play, you know, and it did have the reputation of being, quote, low-class entertainment, right? Because it was sequestered in places like brothels and places like that.
Well, yeah, to make it that, but in the community of players who played jazz, that's how a lot of them made their living, playing music. Yeah. It didn't necessarily, you know, it started with that out of the brothel that Julia was mentioning, but over the years, the music still had to stay alive.
Yeah.
Through the musicians that played it and through the people that heard it. And so young people listened to it and they danced to it. They caught on to that. They wanted to play the trumpet. They wanted to play the trombone. So in during my time coming, everybody played an instrument.
Uh-huh.
Everybody played something. Mm-hmm. And so that was part of the culture of New mm-hmm. Orleans and the city and down south, and how that music, it was just something that you did. You listened mm-hmm. to it and you played it. Your next door neighbor played it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It took on a different connotation other than just the brothel pit part of it. The kids who love the music love the music. If it sounded good, they'll let you know it. If it sounded bad, they would let you know it. So, yeah, it was just part of what we did.
Well, let me ask this, because, you know, and I'm directing this to Julian Moore, because he was before all of us. What did Max Roach and the people that you collaborated with call it?
To clear that up, I'm not sure what the question is.
Okay. What did they call the music that they played? How did they identify with it? Did they use the term jazz, or did they use creative music, or
oh, wow. That's, well, of course they used creative music, but they also had to use the term jazz because that was the title of the product.
Exactly.
Right.
Well, see, all this, the reason why I'm asking this is because I feel that that's very important, that people should know that that was not a name that the artist of your times or our times gave it. They yes. went along with it. Because it's what they utilize as moving the commercial commodity. That's all I'm saying.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Well, the French, you know, it's interesting when you read about it. The French had a term for jazz, and they called it le jazz hot. Le jazz hot. L-E-J-S-S hot. They didn't use Z. My understanding when I read some of the information, but again, the relationship to the music and the lifestyle was what they were talking about. They called it jazz hot. They called it very sensuous. The dance, yeah. Again, drawing what you were saying, Julian, and what you talked about, where the derivation of the music came from. Yeah, it did play in houses of irrepute, all of that as entertainment. But the French identified it as something being unique and very, very sensual. That they were very clear about that, you know.
Yes.
And so, yeah, I understand what you mean by jizz and jazz. I mean, when you talk in terms of those two terms. So getting into you guys individually, had you always, you know, I'm going to start with you, Julian. Had you always thought you were going to be, this is kind of a open-ended question. Do you always thought you would be a musician, that that would be your life and your, you know, your career? Being a musician?
I fell in love with jazz as a child. My siblings, they were jazz fans. They had a collection of records, and they would play the records, and they would react to the sounds of the music, and that was contagious. You know, I mean, I was a baby. I was the baby in the family, the youngest of five siblings. So I was, how can I put it? I was really impressed with how that music affected my siblings. They and their friends would come and get together and listen to the music, and they would get so excited that they would take the needle and put it back and play one passage over and over. You know, it was Charlie Parker. That pretty much explains it. He was such a genius. Charlie Parker was such a genius. And I was impressed with that. I was also impressed with the names of the artists. You know, Bird, Monk, Diz, Paul, you know, Nuke, you know, and those were names that were, how can I put it, like science fiction, you know. And as a child, I was really drawn in to that environment, to that, with those names, with that sound of that music, and the way it impacted, it affected my sibling, my brother. I was sold. And since that time, I fell in love with the music. I stayed in love with the music to this day, you know, 65 years on after, actually more than that. But anyway, I leave that alone.
Okay. Well, that's great. I'm going to ask you, Wadey, did you ever envision yourself, because I'm going to ask Gary the same thing. Did you ever envision yourself, because I grew up with Gary, but did you ever envision yourself as being as so firmly ensconced in music, as a performer, entertainer, and a teacher
growing up? Oh, my. I had some great music teachers. My junior high band director, my high school band director, my college band director. And I was always impressed with how they were able to bring instruments together and create these sounds, you know, orchestra sound, big band sound, marching band sounds. And so I knew early on that, and I like playing music, and I said, you know, that would be a good job to be a teacher. And so I really studied my high school and college band directors and all. I studied what they did and how they approached teaching. So I automatically knew I would be going to teaching. And I had a very good knack of being able to pick up instruments and play them. You know, I played French horn. I was a French horn major at Southern University. My first instrument was a guitar. And my next door neighbor had a guitar. And I said, and he let me try it. And I said, it made sense to me, you know, the sound, how to do it. And so I wanted to play trumpet. So it made sense to press the valves down and create a sound. And from there, I went to the trumpet and trombone and, you know, went to college and you went all the instruments. Before you know it, you know it and still having fun. So that's how I made my living, teaching and playing music. Yes. You know.
Gary, I know a little bit more about Gary because we used to hang out together as kids. But I knew then, Gary, you were going to be a pro. I knew then music was going to be. I don't know if you knew it, but I knew it.
Oh, I didn't. Well, so.
Yeah, because, man, yeah, tell, yeah.
mine really started. I was very shy about it. I was the last one to even start thinking about playing music. But mm-hmm. when my mother and father would have parties, mm-hmm. I'd hear Charlie Parker. But the one that stood out to me, I mean, I love Bert, don't get me wrong, but he was just way over my head. But when she played Gene Ammons, but about 8 or 9 years old, I used to stand up in my bed and act like I was a saxophone player. And my favorite song was Canadian Sunset. And so every time he played that, you know, they'd have parties and they'd be dancing and playing. I could hear them downstairs. I'd stand up in my bed and, you know, act like I was Gene Ammons. So that's how I got started. So then when I turned 16, 17, I actually decided with the truth with that I wanted to play music. And that's how I got into it. And from there, John, you know, I came obsessed.
Yeah.
But you leave me up at, what is that, the park there?
Leshad Park, down at the lake, man.
The lake, and come back and get me early in the morning.
Yeah, like 2 or 3 in the morning, you'd be playing all that music out there.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah. So that's how I really got started. And then from there, and then the cool thing was my brother was playing with Jimi Hendrix and all these guys. So he was already playing. So, mm-hmm. but I was too shy and too afraid to say to him that I wanted to really learn mm-hmm. to do that. So when I got into high school and I just decided that, hey, I don't want to do all this other stuff. I want to play. I like mm-hmm. music. Like Julian say, you know, you hear the sound.
Mm-hmm.
I'd hear the sounds of different guys and I'd stop. Mm-hmm. And then the other thing I did, I would read all the liner notes.
Mm.
I did that as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
So I knew guys before I was even of age to go in and get, people used to say to me, they were real impressed. How do you know so much about what this guy did and that guy did, what New did and this guy? It's on the liner notes because I'd read mm-hmm. it. Yeah. Which That's is gone. You don't find yeah. it anymore.
You don't, right. Well, it's on the little disc or it's on the MP3 or whatever. You're not going to get that info. When you first looked at jazz artists, I'm going to be a little bit, I guess, stereotyping. But most of the jazz artists that I looked at, when my parents used to play swing music, a number of white guys, except when we see Count Basie, Duke Ellington, you know, big band. But when I looked at jazz artists like Sonny Rollins and people, Charlie Parker, you saw people of African descent. And I said, this is truly who inhabited this culture form. What has happened? Why, when you pick up Earshot, I have very rarely seen a brown or black face on that paper. Is that what's happening?
Well, what's happening is people, the industry to start with, which controls who, when, what, how much you're going to get.
Like Julian said, commercial. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Have changed the narrative for people of color, more or less. And it's going to be up to them to find people like Julian, like myself, like Gary Bartz, and like all these great people that are left, and not spend so much time on their computer, just going for what they say is happening. They got to do it. They got to do the work, and then they will begin again to embrace what was a culture that was put in place and what was created on American soil by people of color. That's all. That's the way I see it.
Well, Wade, you taught middle school, and one of the things that I noticed at Meany and Washington, predominantly schools that predominate in the central area, I asked Bob Natt, who was the music teacher at Washington. How come we don't see many more kids of color? Why don't we see more African-American kids? And Bob said to me, John, it's because their parents don't listen to jazz. Do you agree with that, Wadey or Gary and Julian? Is that what we're talking about?
Well, we're coming different generation, John. Of course, I would agree with it. I mean, they may disagree with it. I mean, you know, when we grew up, and when Julian grew up, and he grew up before all of us, we had values in place. I had respect for when I used to see Julian around in New York and when they had Jazzmobile in places. I never came in cocky. I was humble because I understood that they worked hard and that if I was going to even think about doing that, I was going to have to prove to them mm-hmm. that I was worthy of that. And I understand that. So it wasn't on a computer for me to grab.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I had to learn. Now the computer produces what's a lot of the things that I know, and I still don't know anything.
Mm.
But really, that respect has to be there in order. And that, and it's not in order anymore.
Well, Wadey, you taught. How, let me ask you this, Wadey. How many years did you teach in the middle school system?
I was at Meany for 31 years.
31 years. A lot of your kids, yeah. Many of your kids went to Garfield.
Right.
Many of them. Many of them continued to play music, jazz, in the programs. But when you go back now, and we're gonna have to be taking a break real quick, but I gotta make this point. Is it true that one of the reasons why you don't see many Black children playing jazz is because their parents don't play it,
or
their families don't play it?
No. Remember something? In the schools, it's up to the teachers and the educators to encourage all kids to be a part of the arts. They are not, and you have to go out and put together curriculums and give opportunities for music to thrive in the elementary school,
mm-hmm.
the middle school, and high school. We mm-hmm. pay our taxes so that kids can get a well-rounded education. But what happens if you are in an elementary school student wanting to play music, but you only get it for a half an hour once a week?
Itinerant teachers, once a week.
You go to a middle school and they cut the program.
Right.
Or the teachers may not be as savvy to go out and encourage all students, Black, white, brown, orange, green, to get involved in playing.
Mm-hmm.
Students want to know you care about what that you want to encourage them to be a part of this thing called music.
Yeah.
And in particular, and also with calling it jazz, if you want to call it a stage band, a big band, orchestra, mm-hmm. all it's music. Mm-hmm. So if you're not willing to dig down and go and reach out to the kids, they're going to find other things to do.
Yeah.
But see, I'm finding too, through the community by going out and talking, that a lot of the kids that come from broken homes and don't have the same opportunities, and their parents are not listening to jazz. I've had discussions about that right there at that coffee shop with young parents that don't know these things and mm-hmm. that didn't have some of the things that you are talking about that were provided. Mm-hmm. So, you know, so we have to look at that several different ways.
Of course,
You know,
absolutely. And when we come back, we're going to take a short break. Julian, I want to come back because I want to hit you up because you taught at the collegiate level. And I know their perspective is going to be, I hope, you know, like I said, if you don't mind. Hey, you're listening to Seattle Here and Now on Rainier Avenue Radio.world. My very special guest, Julian Priester, Wadey Irvin, Gary Hammond. We're talking about jazz. Where are we with jazz today? Where is jazz today? Come on back. We'll be right back, folks.
I'm Paul Pearson, host of Startime, and this is my real voice. Honest, you're hearing it on Rainier Avenue Radio.world.
You have an idea for a community project in your neighborhood? You could be eligible for up to $50,000 in funding through the City of Seattle's Neighborhood Matching Program. Grants are awarded to grassroots projects that build stronger communities, with an emphasis on projects led by impacting Black, Indigenous, and people of color BIPOC communities. Learn more about the Neighborhood Matching Fund or to see visit seattle.gov/neighborhoods/NMF.
Mga kaibigan, ito po si Kuya Bert Kawili.
And this is Miles Salvador from Australia.
And I'm Norb Kawili, also known as NorbCam.
Gusto niyo po ang latest news and events from the Philippines at the local Filipino community, PhilAm Radio po.
We play Filipino music and interview guests from all around the world.
And I'll keep you updated on the latest Seahawks and sports news.
Kaya always tune in PhilAm Radio every Tuesday 1 to 2:30 p.m. Pacific Time on RainierAvenueRadio.org.
And in YouTube and Facebook. Salamat po.
What's up, everyone? It's your girl, Queen Bree, inviting you to come join me on Queen Bree's Living. Broadcasted Tuesdays, 12:30 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, live right here on Rainier Avenue Radio. On Queen Bree's Living, we talk farming, community, and ways to being healthy. So come join me and let's discuss ways to create a healthier you and a healthier community.
Generational wealth. Generational wealth. Generational wealth. What is generational wealth? We asked our communities.
And this is what they had to say.
Generational wealth to me means to provide and establish wealth for generations to come, whether it be through real estate or through other equitable funding, stocks, bonds, you know. But first of all, I think that general wealth starts with securing property.
And that's it.
This campaign to create awareness to generational wealth is brought to you by the Department of Neighborhoods Generational Wealth Initiative, the Washington Housing Finance Commission, and RainierAvenueRadio.org.
Create your generational wealth for you and the future of your families.
You know you can't get enough of RainierAvenueRadio.org.
All right. Very short break. We are back. We are back, ladies and gentlemen, to my, again, honored and very special guest, Julian Priester, Wade Urban, Gary Hammond. Great performers, great artists, great musicians, great teachers, and just great people. I got a couple of things I got to mention. We got baseball, Metro League Baseball tomorrow, Chief South at Seattle Prep at 3:30. It'll be your sportscaster will be Juan Cotto. Next week, Earth Deserves More Than a Day. All week, next week, April 17th through the 21st. Hey, check us out. Go online. Earth Deserves More Than a Day. Conversation and stories and film dealing with issues involving environment, as well as issues involving environmental justice. That is an issue that is predicated across, well, it's prevalent across this country, and it's predicated on the disparities that occur because of our environmental consequences, and especially in an urban setting. Urban asthma is one of the deleterious things of living in the urban setting, and it affects a very large number of African Americans as well as other children of color. And we got all Metro Sports Weekly coming in right after this show. You'll have a high school soccer player and Sounders football club reporter, Owen Murray, who will be the special guest. So stay tuned to Masvita and Pat on Metro Sports Weekly coming up. So let's get back into it, because Julian and Gary and Wadey, thank you for hanging in. We got to do our little announcements and stuff. You know, we don't get – it's not commercial, but we got to still make them. And the reason why I asked you, Julian, because you taught at the – basically Cornish, I'll call it collegiate level, higher ed level. What, I mean, like I said, I'm talking to two gentlemen who teach at the high school level as well as middle school level. Is it any different, your approach with young people at the collegiate level or at that level, higher ed level? are they just as interested and just as curious or what? You know, I'd like your take, you know, if you don't mind.
Unmute.
Oh, I'm sorry, you're muted. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, all right, good. All right, so at the advanced level there, I didn't really concentrate on the nuts and bolts, you know. Mm-hmm. I felt that if the students were at that level, that they already had the nuts and bolts already taken care of. So what I concentrated on was how to listen and how to be a critic while you're playing, while you're creating. You know, the two things don't go together.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you're going to be weighing the worth of the music or the value of the music that you are actually creating at that moment, then you're interfering with the process.
Mm.
If you're going to be creating, you have to fire the critic, get rid of the critic.
Okay. Right?
And then you'll be free to create, you know? You don't want to be stuck repeating old ideas.
Mm-hmm.
You want to open your mind and mm-hmm. be receptive to foreign ideas.
Uh-huh.
I use the term foreign because these are things that you didn't practice in the practice room. These are things that you heard in the moment and responded to. Okay,
mm-hmm.
That's what's important about the music that we call jazz. You know, there's a difference between hearing and listening.
Mm-hmm.
I taught the students how to listen. I made them aware of an important mm-hmm. of listening. You know, listen before you play a note.
Mm.
Listen to the sound of air.
Mm-hmm.
Listen to the sound of traffic. You know, listen to whatever sound is. You know, if you got stage lights and the stage lights are buzzing and making different noises, listen to that, because there is music in everything.
That is incredible. I have to say this. Then I met a young lady, and I told her, and we got to talking about music, and I talked about my son Carter and Garpy and jazz and people I know. You know, probably named all of you guys, and then. I said, do you listen to jazz? And she says, no, I don't like to listen to jazz because it makes me think. and I'm not, this is what she actually said to me.
Yes.
I'm going to tell you, I almost slid out of my chair.
Yeah.
And I just could not believe she said that. And you're telling me, listen, Wade's the same thing. All these things, Gary. Everything that you feel, everything you know, everything that you is playing, you're putting it out there. And she's telling me she doesn't like to listen to it because it makes her think.
Well, see,
she was a young lady, nice person too, you know.
You have to remember that's where it all happens. I mean, when I started, remember?
Yeah.
I learned by listening.
Yep.
You know. Now, before I came to Seattle, I was up under Aaron Bell teaching at Essex County College. So just as not doing the same thing Julian was doing, but doing ensembles and workshops.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, to me, expressing themselves was very important. Mm-hmm. I didn't care. I used to say my term was, there are no wrong notes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, right.
No wrong notes. You know. And I said once you get away from that, you're able to move forward and not worry about if you did something right, because you're not going to do it the way Charlie Parker did it. I don't care what you do. You're just not going to do it, you know. So, I understand what he's saying about that. But
coming
to middle school,
that's pretty
high school, it was different for me. I had to change
mm-hmm.
my whole, you know, I mean, I really had to come from another direction to go back. So I thank Bob Knapp for letting me have that job, because I had to reteach myself how to discipline and do very, very basic fundamental things with people. And yeah, that was tough. That really was. But I'm glad I did it, though. Because
mm-hmm.
fundamentals are it. That's the key.
You know, Wade, when you started out, you started on various instruments. You gravitated, to the bass, electric bass.
Right.
Those of you who played with Joe Brazil, that, to me, was one of the greatest efforts in the community.
Oh, it was amazing. It was amazing.
And your experience with Joe.
I was playing when I was in the academy. I played the trumpet. So I played the trumpet, but I was moving into playing the bass.
Mm-hmm.
And if I tell you, Buddy Catlett gave me a couple of lessons, and I will forever be thankful to him. He made it sound so understanding how you approach playing the bass.
Mm-hmm.
He made it so simple. He said, just keep it simple, man. You know, just don't, you don't have to work hard. And the light just went on like that. And so from that point on, you know, I knew you have to put time in learning the instrument, but you also have to put, as Judy was saying, you have to learn to listen too.
Yeah.
You know, and so, wow, yeah, the Academy was a good stepping stone for a lot of people, you know, that mm-hmm. came through the Academy, and you got a chance to meet a lot of great musicians who would take the time to share information with you. And so you learn by talking, and, you know, George Hertzman said, well, this is how you play this idea.
Mm.
And you listen to what they're talking about, and you say, yeah, these guys know what they're talking about.
Yeah.
You know, George, speaking of George, Julian didn't get to meet George. Did you know George? He was in San Francisco. Boss George, One-Eyed George.
No, I didn't know him.
Okay, what a great guitar player.
Wow, yeah.
George, and a great musician. I mean, he played piano, trombone, everything. But George was the one who taught me how to solo, Julian. He took me out on a gig with him, and I couldn't solo. And he'd turn around and say, not dead, Gary. We in G. Check this out. And then he'd hum something, and then I'd start playing on the horn. He'd say, yeah. You know, just keep it there.
That's right. That's it.
But that was it. That's how I learned, was him doing that. I thank him for that. I had to bring him up because I ended up later on getting him and Jimmy Smith together. And Jimmy thanked me. Jimmy wanted to take him and continue the tour with him and Willie Bobo with George, because I think the guitar player they had got sick, but they couldn't find George. They only had him for a weekend.
Mm.
I don't know what happened. Maybe, you know, you never know about him, you know. But yeah, what a name to call. I think you would have loved him, Julian. He was quite a guitar player.
Yeah.
Have any of you decided you wanted to chronicleize your past history with guys you played with and places you played and the things you've been able to accomplish? I mean, I've heard all three of you play. Amazing stuff. Have you ever thought about writing it down and putting it on paper, pen to ink kind of thing?
I've made a few feeble efforts to do that. I've got, you know, notes all over the place, but nothing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, in my heart, yeah, I would love to do that, but I haven't done it.
You know, Gary, you guys, all of you guys that play with, you know, other, you know, great players, all that stuff, have you guys ever thought about putting it on in writing in a book, Wade?
Well, I've thought about it, but, you know, over the years, I think my documentation goes into the students that I taught.
Yeah. Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
That's where my treasure is, and living through them, and they passing on information and doing the things that they want to do as adults and musicians, if they want to continue to play or whatever their passion is.
I don't know if Gary knew it or Julie knew, but you taught Carter how to play the bass.
Yeah.
I mean, I was amazed.
Yeah.
Amazed. You know, he still plays it. He plays the piano and the bass.
And bass, right. Yeah. And trumpet, all of it.
Interesting. So I heard from different sources that they're really looking at cutting the program back at Washington Middle School for sure. I know that's one school, but that's pretty much the pattern. Whenever there's a shortage of money in the district, the arts programs get cut.
Right.
Which means music, fine arts, performing arts, all of that stuff gets cut.
Yeah. Well, when it was at its height, it was disassembled once Nat stepped down. It was surely disassembled when Bob Nat left.
Jeez.
The vision of what he had, all someone had to do was continue the legacy. No, what did they do? They destroyed it, and now we have Jazz Ed.
Hmm. Well, that's interesting.
I mean, really, I'm just going to say it the way it is. I'll spell it out. Hey. Because that was a very powerful program. I came in on the end of it, recognizing all the awards that had been won, Julian, by Bob Nat. I mean, there were several. There were so many trophies he had won because of and Mr. Irving here, because they were the feeder schools to the high school.
Garfield and Roosevelt. Yep.
So the attention not only never went to them, and I commend you, Wadey, for that. It went to the directors in the high schools. Well, they didn't teach the kids. They directed the kids. Yeah. They could already play.
Right.
One of the teachers. They could play. So, you know, to take it further, what bothers me, what troubles me since we're on the subject, when you have Hot Java Jazz, what about a night for the teachers that taught them?
Yeah. 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 Honor the teachers.
There's a lot of teachers before I even came back to Seattle that deserved to be recognized for that. None of that. None of that.
Yeah.
Again, the politics play in.
Right.
Yeah. Now, so the attitude of the students that are out here that have graduated and went on, they feel that they are it.
Yep.
You know, that's not the way I came under Julie and them. I came humble. And I've been humble all my life. Because there's a whole lot of cats in New York they don't talk about. And one of his best friends that they don't talk about, Charles Davis, one of the baddest cats I ever seen in my life.
Yeah. Mm.
Not only from a playing standpoint, but from a writing standpoint. And a beautiful person. These kids don't know about him.
Yeah, but, you know, again, when you look at it, it's all about money. It's all about money and how you can sequester it to finance these programs. Public school gets financed through the state. Levies get passed. Yeah, sure. But it's still an issue of money and finances. K-12 education is, you know, like I said, at the mercy of, and look at the enrollments. The enrollments are all down in Seattle schools,
right.
You know, public schools. And I'm not saying it's a better scenario at a place like Cornish or other places, because it's still a money issue. But when I go to Cornish, I'm paying for my music. I'm paying for my, you know, I'm paying for it. So I have some say. But in public school, you send your child to the nearest public school, and that's it. I tell people, don't kid yourself. We had to pay for Carter's jazz experience at Garfield, you know, and to some degree at Washington, because there was never enough money to give them that experience. And I appreciate the heck out of Bob Nat, because he was recruiting all the kids of color that he could get into his group, his band, for sure, with all the other kids that were interested. And I know you did the same thing, Wadey, because I look at the students that you worked with.
Yeah.
You put a great effort into getting them involved, and you've always done that. And Julian, too. I mean, but we have seemed to, and Gary, you too, you know what I mean? You had ballots.
No, well, listen, I came on the tail end of it.
Yeah.
And the credit goes to Wadey and Mr. Nat. I mean, I'm being real. You know, Julian was here teaching too, but I knew Julian somewhere else, and through San Francisco and New York and stuff. So he was already on who knows how many different records.
Right.
If people don't even look now today and realize, it's a shame. It's because they're misled. They push a button, and when they're speaking about artists, they're talking about people that are not African American.
Yeah.
Not at all. And that's all right. It's all right for them to have their perspective. Yeah. But remember, it was created by us. We have one too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you really want to learn about it.
You're right. You're right.
But you know, that is true. I think how many high schools and middle schools teach jazz history in this area?
Well, I mean, I did when I was at Meany.
Yeah, but you're not there. You retired. Well, yeah,
I've been retired for 18 years now. So
yeah,
I taught music. I was, you know, that was part of.
Yeah, just
always wanted to know, but
where did it come? Right.
To be willing to share that information with the students and make them become interested in learning more about it, learning about what's going on with it. We as taxpayers must insist that the arts be a major part of all curriculums.
Yep.
Because the politics of it will say, let's push this to the side and put our focus on basic education. Well, what's basic education? Arts are basic education.
Yeah,
exactly.
It's a basic. It's a need, like Julian was saying. It's something that all people feel inside of them.
Yeah.
Some form of fashion.
Yeah.
And everything we deal with today, modern technology, is through art. Sound. It's music.
Yeah. No, you're right.
So, I mean, all that has to be looked upon, and it has to be adopted and not put into appropriate conversation to make something else exist.
So let me ask you, I'm going to put you on the spot, Julian. I'm going to put Gary and Wade on the spot. Has jazz been stolen, misappropriated, and basically taken from the rightful owners and the creators of it? African Americans or people of African descent. Is that a true statement?
Jazz has been appropriated by capitalism, and its identity has been destroyed.
Whitewashed.
Yeah. Okay. Whitewashed. That's a good term. So, as long as they can create money.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And that's the whole purpose of a commodity.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Jazz has been turned into a commodity. So if you understand that, and if you agree with and support the commodification of product.
Yeah.
Of art. Yeah, okay, let me put it like that, because that's what happened to jazz. This one example. After World War II, during the war, the record companies were hampered by the shortage of vinyl.
Right.
Okay, the vinyl was used in the war effort, so there wasn't enough vinyl for the record companies to produce records. Mm. When the war was over, now this is a key point here. When the war was over, soldiers came back home, the country recovered and everything. Commodification dictated that, we got to excite the public. They have to excite the people with
masses.
The masses. to you have to cite them so they can spend money.
Right.
Yeah, buy records, right.
Buy records, yeah. So they did a smart thing. Let me try and explain what I mean when I say, because I hated this. Not only did I hate it, but most of the East Coast music artists, like jazz players, hated this. The record companies decided that they could make a lot of money if they started to record the West Coast music. Mm. So, and the poor Miles, I love him, but he took advantage of it. He was very smart. He took advantage of it.
Mm-hmm.
He hired a bunch of West Coast musicians and recorded them. And
Birth of the Cool.
And anytime you turn on the radio, that's what you heard. You heard Gary Mulligan.
Yeah, a bunch of white guys.
Yeah.
Chet Baker.
Yeah. Julie London.
Yep.
I love this woman, Rosemary Clooney.
Oh yeah, Rosemary. George Clooney. Don't.
Rosemary Clooney sang with Duke Ellington.
Yep.
Oh, and she's just warmed my heart. You know, every time I hear her, you know.
Yeah, but.
And again, of course, she suffered because she wasn't going to go to the commercial side.
Yeah. You know,
she kept pouring her heart out, and that's what's needed, you know, to express jazz. So jazz music is it comes from the inside, the mm-hmm. feeling of it, the message behind it, you know, mm-hmm. life. It's a celebration of life.
Yeah.
You know? And that aspect has been forgotten.
You know, I heard an interview, I watched it, with Johnny Carson and Miles.
Oh, okay.
And I loved it because the chickens came home to roost. He looked at Miles and he said, well, you know, your behavior is so inappropriate when you're on the bandstand. Why is that? And so Miles said, well, if Jerry Mulligan is opening for you and he's making $85,000 and I'm making $25,000, yours would be inappropriate too.
Yeah. Well, that's a good point. But yeah, here we go again, the misappropriation and how it's been directed. Wadey, would you agree? That has been stolen, has been taken, is appropriated and misappropriated by the people who didn't create it.
Well, I think I like how Julian puts it in terms mm-hmm. of, but that's, what do we do now? I guess it's the next mm-hmm. thing.
Yep.
Because we can, since we're in a capitalist society,
yeah.
Now we have the tools to bring some of that capital back to the people, to the jazz musician.
Yes.
So that's the other side of the coin that we can't, you know, we can't go back.
Yeah. And
now we have to figure out how do we go forward to make sure that the capital comes right back to the people who created this thing called jazz.
Yes.
So the future jazz players will understand that part of the business of music.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's
not lose the soul of jazz at the same time.
That
you know you can have all the money in the world, but if you lose your soul, what do you have?
Yeah,
yeah.
Well, it's all for nothing. Gary, you said it too. Snoop and all these guys make millions. They don't support jazz, right?
No, I mean, listen, John Coltrane is not blue-eyed and blonde hair,
right?
When you look at what's going on out here, you have to start from generations to come. You have to start with young ones.
Yeah.
The educational system has to be turned around, which Wadey already said and Julian said. So the young ones learn about the history.
Yep.
You can't take somebody that's 16 or 15 years old.
They're too old.
They've come into their own.
Yeah.
And they've come to believe that the trend setting is the way of life unless they wake up. Yeah. And we were all there. When you wake up,
we'll be there. We'll be back next week on the 20th. We'll be on at 7 p.m. next week. We're going to continue. Hopefully, I'll get everybody back. You're listening to Seattle Here and Now on Rainier Avenue Radio.World. My special guest, Julian Priester, Wade Irvin, and Gary Hammond. We will see you next week. That's April 20th at 7 p.m. Folks, we'll continue the discussion about jazz.